Saskatchewan because this is a good place to be. But people, I'm quite certain, would rather be supported in their home community than us becoming a destination point. And to that, one of the neat things that we'd like to see is that while this report says Yellowknife, it means NWT, because we're all part of the NWT. And if the things that are happening in Yellowknife could be recognized by the people that sit in the round dome and the people that work for them a little bit more, it might spread out the interest and the response. And I say that out of a little frustration because I was in a much more boring meeting yesterday talking about energy futures, and I got a copy of the NWT Energy Strategy, which mentioned Yellowknife as the place of where our conference had it in the white zone of the geothermal, which means that it's never going to happen there. And that was the only mention of the many, many years of our community energy planning. And that's, I mean, it's a symptom, but we really need to embrace the entire picture so that it doesn't centralize in one area, and because it's not so much that it's ignored. There's huge contribution from the GNWT, but it's not talked about, and as such, it doesn't generalize. So much for my commercial questions. Please identify yourself.
Hi, Lydia Bardak, John Howard Society and City Council, and I'm sorry I had to step out for a little bit, but I have a day job that I have to pay attention to a little bit. It's not a question so much as a comment. I remember several years ago when I heard Lida Fuller saying that the YWCA houses the largest number of people with disabilities in the Northwest Territories in their programs. And sadly, that's no longer true. I've actually had a guard at the correctional center say to me, half of the guys in here don't belong in here, they're mental. So we now have North Slave Correctional Center housing most of the disabled people in the Northwest Territories. It was probably 8 to 10 years ago that the place was being designed, and there's four living units there with 40 men each, and then a couple of other smaller units for various kinds of segregation. So total capacity of something like 156 or 158, and when it was being designed, somebody said, do you suppose that we could use one of those units of 40 as a remand unit? And the response was, don't be ridiculous. We'll never have 40 remanded inmates. We don't even have 20. Today we have 80. So they can fill two of those units with people who have not been convicted of any crime. And any defense counsel in town will tell you that the primary reason that people are being held in custody and can't get released before a sentencing or a trial is that they don't have housing. If there was some place to release them to, a house or a home that they could be released to, they would be out of there. So there is enough money. There's more than enough money. In this country, we have wait lists for child care. We have wait lists for social housing. We don't have wait lists for jail. Everybody can get in there. Even people who don't belong there can get in there. So the cost of operating corrections in this country and all the, you know, the courts and everything else, is huge. So the money is there, and we're investing it very unwisely. Because when these people with mental illness finally get to either a trial or sentencing, they're typically released at that point with time served, or there's just no other reason to hold them. So they're back on the streets until they can get back in the criminal justice system, because there is no other system of supports for them. So the money is there, and let's figure out how we're investing, because an investment in corrections has never helped anyone and is not a wise one.
Hi, my name is Sandra Lockhart. I'm a member of It's Okay, the Dene Band of First Nations. I agree a lot with what Lila was saying, and I want to focus in more on being a First Nations person. When you talk about housing with CHMC, are you also including the fiduciary obligation that they have with First Nations peoples within the NWT? When you talk about the decrease of funding, is that also inclusive of the funding they have for us for housing? That would be to you, sorry.
Yes. That is helpful. What I'm referring to is the money that CMHC provides to the Housing Corporation now. So it's not related to any funding that they may directly provide to Aboriginal governments across the territory. That's a different element altogether. But this is specifically to the money that CMHC provides to the government of the Northwest Territories now for those housing programs that they basically said we're getting out of that business. And so it's sliding down towards zero at the end of about 20 years or so.
Okay. So this, and I have another point. I meet a lot of men, and I'm beginning to meet Aboriginal sisters that find their housing in corrections. And, you know, we know about the trauma that our people have went through, the intergenerational trauma of colonization, and we're still under it. We're still assaulted with it every day. Part of my frustration is my husband and I own a house, and because of the Indian Act, we can't use that as collateral, so we haven't got the funds because both him and I live very traumatized lives and started life fairly late, especially myself. So we don't have the means to buy a house. The house here, you need $500,000, but I can't use that as collateral because under the treaty, it's on Crown land. If it's on Crown land, it has got no value in the market system. So it's really frustrating to me. We can't even get involved in holding in equity, even though the lands that I was adopted into, and it's okay, we're rich with resources. And the people of the North are benefiting from those resources. And yet we seem to have the least ability to get in there and get involved with anything that I own at an individual level. So there's that issue about the Indian Act and how it cuts me out of competing for a house. I can't even use the equity I have because of the Indian Act. The other issue is I have children that, grandchildren, that have disabilities. And I know for a fact that when they turn 14, 16, or 16, they're going to start falling through cracks because we don't have services for them when they get of a certain age. And that terrifies me. I mean, they're already fighting with cultural identity, and I'm strong in it, but I got to educate them in it. But that we don't have jobs for them. I'm trying to find, my son is 15, we custom adopted him, he's my oldest grandson. I'm trying to find employment, but he has to have a resume, but he has a disability, but there's nothing for him. So he goes out and he volunteers and he feels so great if he makes $5. He'll make contributions. But what does that do for him? Because he's going to be 17, 18. He doesn't want to go to school anymore because he doesn't do well in it and it affects his self-esteem. I have another girl that is just got diagnosed. She behaves very much like FASD, but they say she has a learning disability. As soon as she starts to get into more abstract, she's gone. So she's acting out, she's frustrated, she's falling behind, she's going to be in those cracks. And God help me, I hope I live long enough, or she's not going to have a place to live. Because as soon as we move out of our communities, it's like we're gone and we don't get housing. So she's on the streets in Yellowknife, and where are the services? They're centralized in Yellowknife. So when you look at poverty and you look at homelessness, that's really a socialization process. So when I think about Aboriginal peoples, just in our communities, and I've listened to your statistics, and I think that, yeah, it's Yellowknife focused, because we're being pulled to Yellowknife for services. We haven't got housing, but we're the ones on the streets that you see every day. And it just keeps generating and robbing of us of who we are as the First Peoples in the NWT. So I think that when you take a look at this, you have to look at how you're socializing people. Even the terms you use for communities is very different than what you use for your regional centers. You've already categorized us. So, I mean, that needs to be addressed, and there needs to be trauma centers. You know, we talk about addictions, but a lot of that is trauma. I have a guy that I meet regularly that gets out of corrections, that he wants to go back there because he can't handle it on the streets anymore. And it's because he's FASD, but he's not getting diagnosed because he can't settle down enough to get diagnosed. And when he does find a place to live, the rules and the policies, he can't meet them. So, I mean, I agree, it's really big, but you have to look at how you're socializing Aboriginal people. Let's see.
Thank you.
Is it okay if I ask a question?
Only if you don't already know the answer.
It's your party.
So, I've got a question for David Stewart. It's a long-term question. First of all, David, thanks again for coming, and thanks for meeting with me and Arlene on Tuesday. We really enjoyed the opportunity, and thanks for reading the report well in advance of the meeting. The report finds that independent living support units, the kind run by the YWCA, are quite cost-effective. It requires some staffing, but not 24-hour staffing. It involves quite a level of independence for the resident. A lot of people in the room are no doubt aware that the Mental Health Commission of Canada is studying that model right now. They're looking at that kind of supported housing, and they're looking at what happens when you give people who are on the street homeless immediate access to that kind of housing. And they're spending $110 million to study it, actually, and I'm happy to report it's federal money, not territorial money. It's a long-term study. And they've got two groups. They're looking at what happens when homeless people are given a unit like that, and they're contrasting that with what happens when a homeless person just doesn't get it. And over the long term, they're going to look at how successful it is. I think their hunch is that it will work because it's been shown to be effective in other jurisdictions, including Toronto and a lot of American jurisdictions. But I'm just wondering, going forward into the next assembly, as results come in from that study, insofar as results end up showing that that's an effective model, to what extent do we have reason for hope that those results could translate into more units of independent living support in the NWT?
Thanks, Dick. As you mentioned, there's a study going on now. I would like to think that with the shelter policy review, that we should be starting with a pretty blank sheet of paper. I think we need to look at all of the possible options. As I mentioned, the finances aren't great. And I want to thank Sandra for her comments, because I do think that we have to, there are so many issues, and they are big, but you got to start, I tell my teenage children all the time, the way you eat an elephant is one bite at a time. So I think that's where you do need to start. But I'm very keen, and I'd ask you to send some information on that, because I do think we have to look at creative solutions. I think I won't go as far as saying that what we do now doesn't work, because there has been a lot of successes on the housing front, but there's lots of problems as well. And so I think we do have to get creative, and so I absolutely would look forward to that information and for the results and say, how could that apply here? What would we do? How would it work? What's the cost elements of that? Being a bit on the analytical side relative to other approaches, and where would it be most effective? And I also think that one of the things we do sometimes in the Northwest Territories that gets us in trouble is assuming that you have to do the same thing everywhere. And I think we have to get a little more creative than that as well. So.
Wendy wants to talk.
Thank you. I just wanted to add to what David has said, and I think in talking about independent living or independent supported living, most of it I think now is funded through the Department of Health and Social Services, but it's not really a health issue, or it is a social issue, but it's not really a health issue. And it goes to the statement that's the recommendation in the report about the need for a homeless secretariat. And you know, to my point about the coordination across departments, I had an issue with a constituent who, and I know that there's many in Yellowknife, I think the report cites 30 people on a waiting list for independent supported living, and I know that to be true. And that it is a home ownership or a home, it's a problem of providing someone with a home, a place to live. And it's been proven that it's cheaper, but it shouldn't be funded, in my mind, through Health and Social Services Department. It should be funded through sort of cross-departmental and through a government entity of some sort. And I just wanted to emphasize that I think establishing a homeless secretariat or something like that, because I do firmly believe the anti-poverty strategy needs to be folded in there as well, that is something which we can do and which will make it a bit broader than just looking at providing homes for people. The shelter policy review is great, but it's being done by the Housing Corporation. And you know, whatever you can do, Dave, because I know that you're open to hearing from all kinds of people, but whatever you can do to go beyond just what the Housing Corporation does and involve all departments and all programs. And I want to throw in here, just because I can get my words in, I think you need to talk to users of social housing, which I don't know is necessarily on your list. Anyways, thanks for indulging me.
Wendy and I get lots of chance to talk, so I'm not absolutely users. And just to be clear on the shelter policy review, it is, we call it shelter as opposed to a housing review, because it does have to include all of the services in the entire continuum, including those provided by health and others. So it, yes, you got my commitment on that one.
Arlene.
There's a few, I think, important points that I'd like to raise. One is around frustration in kind of probably being here for this long and watching the GNWT in particular just sort of, in my view, being immobilized about what they do. And if you, it's just really striking when you go back to, you know, for example, around the mental health issue. When you go back to 1979, the recommendations in 1979 are no different than the recommendations today. So when you look at the scope of that and kind of the repeated pattern of having good recommendations and the GNWT not able to really make those work, and how they sort of get off track, then just as a community person who is trying at this end to make some change, I'm interested in structural changes that might help that. You know, for example, if you look at the addiction change, the changes around services related to addictions, where a piece of research was done, and based on that, the government of Northwest Territories insisted that all addiction workers work for them and do it in a certain way. And they've done that several times, and that way has not been proven to be effective. So what that did really was take community people that somebody could talk to at the very minimum, not the best in some ways, but somebody, and they removed that community resource and made it something different. And what they made it was somebody who can't talk to people, but you can refer people. So I kind of laughed because I said to the government person I was arguing about, I said, this isn't working. And they said, that's what the community want. That's what they want. And I said, I have never heard a community person say, I need somebody to refer me somewhere. They always say, I need somebody to talk to. So what I'm concerned about is the 30-year history. Because most people are new, so they wonder why I'm frustrated. That's what my impression. But it's because I've watched for 30 years where we're on the same track and we're immobilized. And how can we change that? One of the key ways to change that, I think, is to really strengthen that relationship between the government and the nonprofit sector. And through the declaration around that relationship, we could insist, for example, that all committees or all efforts around, say, poverty or homelessness or this shelter review start out by including people other than the GNWT. Because I have to take somebody's word at this moment that things will go well. Everybody will be heard and it will do what it needs to do. But the only people that are involved are policy people, not really service delivery people. So that would just leave me concerned, because history would tell me, and what's that saying? Fool me once, shame on me, fool me twice, well, whatever, you know what I mean. And then the other, so I'm interested in how we can structurally change the relationship between the community and the government to have positive change. The other sort of thing that I'd like to talk about a bit is harm reduction approaches, and sort of different approaches and how that happens. And the Center for Northern Families has really often been at the forefront, sort of in a perceived not to be in a great way in the forefront, around insisting things change. So for example, if you look at the addiction arena again, the Center for Northern Families was a key group who insisted 20 years ago that we move from addictions to trauma-informed treatment, because we have a population that has been traumatized by colonization and by lots of other stuff. And it was such a struggle and such a fight. And now everybody talks about it. And I'll just go back to the Healthy Family Program for a second. The Center for Northern Families was the very first organization that started a family support, healthy family type program. Because we opposed child welfare practices, we were defunded, literally defunded, because child welfare didn't trust us. And so they decided to offer that service. So when you talk about people just having a bit of a problem with child welfare, running that program, that's a really valid fear that community people have that could be addressed really easily, but it won't be. So I'm really kind of, again, interested in the difference between the community offering a service and the government offering a service, and how can we make sure that it's the most effective way of doing it and use the both of best worlds to kind of get that done. Because we need child welfare for sure, because they have a certain role to play. Can they play the role of supporter? Not with their history and not in my view. That's just my view. But the reason I'm bringing those issues up specifically is because I think the Center for Northern Families probably is the only organization that I've heard at this point not want to leap quickly back into establish a treatment center. So there's a high demand by everybody I've heard from who wants another treatment center established. And I would oppose that, because history told me that became such an entrenched, unhealthy service that you couldn't move it into anything that was too effective. So I just want a dialogue, if nothing else, because maybe I'm wrong. I've been wrong many times. But I find that the dialogue doesn't happen. It's kind of a little group that kind of decides. And if there's opposition to that, then that opposition is silent instead of a healthy dialogue. So I'm interested in how that dialogue happens. I think I'll end it on that, but those are kind of, I'm interested in, as a northerner here for 2 years, and if you were at the Social Agenda Conference, you would have heard from northerners who have been born and raised here, elders and, you know, people who have watched the GNWT be immobilized for decades. They've given up. I still haven't. That's the scary part. I might be a little cynical, but there's still a kernel there that says, you know, it can happen. And in fact, I ran into the MLA who won't run again, Dave Kruko. I said, is it worth it? Did you actually achieve anything? He said, I'm pretty cynical. And so I'm sitting there thinking, you are a politician and you're a bureaucrat. Can you actually see that a difference can be made? I'm not convinced, but maybe. So those structural changes, I think, are critical. So I'm looking to Dave and to Wendy to talk about that. Thanks.
Yeah.
You want me to go first, Dave, so you can refute? I'll give Dave the opportunity to refute everything I say. Just kidding. He and I do get along really well. Arlene, I appreciate the comments and the question, and it's a really difficult question to answer. The Standing Committee on Social Programs did a large review on Child and Family Services Act, and we toured, I think, almost 12 communities, and probably 90% of the comments we heard in communities was that people wanted supports in their communities. And what I see relative to your question is that we've created, in the first place, policies, and in the second place, standards, which become the box into which everything has to fit. And, you know, to your statement about, you know, people just needing somebody to talk to, whether that was you or whether that was Lydia, I forget. But absolutely, I see an opportunity in any community. Yellowknife's maybe a little bit easier, but in the smaller communities, there should be someone in the community who isn't necessarily qualified, so to speak, with a degree or a master's or whatever, but they do have the capability to be a resource for somebody who needs to talk or who needs, even if it's referral, whatever. But we require those people, I think, at this point, and I haven't done a lot of research into it, but in general, we require those people to have some sort of qualification. And we don't have people in our communities that have those qualifications on paper. They have them in their skills, they have them in their ability to deal with people and so on, but the government says, well, you can't do it unless you've got this piece of paper which says you've got those skills and qualifications. So that, I think, changing those sort of guidelines and labels would help, but there's the issue of liability that always rears its ugly head, and almost the first thing that'll come from, not necessarily a bureaucrat, but from some, from the department or from a minister will be, well, we can't do that because the government's going to be held liable and you know, it's going to cost us millions and we're going to be sued and et cetera, et cetera. I appreciate that, but I still believe there's a way around it. How we get there, I really struggle with that. The assembly, as members, as all 19 members, we're not on the same page all of the time. Occasionally, yeah, we are. But in terms of these issues, I find members still focus too much on their own riding, their own constituents, and don't see the bigger picture. And until we get an assembly where the majority of members are looking at the big picture and what's good for the whole of the NWT, I really am somewhat pessimistic that we will make great advances. But I'm ever hopeful that we'll get there. I haven't given up hope, absolutely. So over to you, Dave.
I think standing committee is where I refute most of what you say, Wendy, so I think we're okay here. I just want to talk about a couple of things you meant, Verlene, and I think you first off, don't let yourself get frustrated because we need people like you, and so I absolutely want to make sure that you stay pushing us as hard as you can. This balance between, something Wendy alluded to, the effectiveness versus efficiency, and I mean the example of the alcohol and drug counselors is a good one of you know, there may have been a lot of very, very good reasons, and I'm not a program specialist, of why you need to, or why the government moved towards being employees, needing certification, you know, all of those very good things. But if it doesn't work, then you can be as efficient as you like, but if it just doesn't work, it just doesn't work. And certainly in the depths of some of the housing policies I've already looked at, there's some very good reasons why they put those policies in place. But at the end of the day, when you say, but how does that help anybody? There's sort of a lot of blank stares of maybe it doesn't. And so how do you balance those two become a real part of the challenge here of making sure that, because efficiency does matter in that we do have limited financial resources, but there also effectiveness matters just as much. And so if we keep banging our head against the same wall and not getting anywhere, I think we have to be, as a territory, more willing, and it's a challenge, I guess, to the political level, more willing to say, yeah, we're going to cut that program. There's going to be people mad as hell about it, but it's just not working, and we have to stop doing it and go a different direction. And that's a very, very difficult thing in our system to do. The other thing that you talked about is the relationship between the NGO community and government. And I would broaden it out from the NGO community to, or the NGO organizations to community generally. I think, you know, it's been around for a long time as well, 25 years or so, and you see this sort of, there is a bit of a treadmill that goes on, and ideas kind of, or a carousel where ideas keep coming around, but certainly in the poverty consultations that we did out in the communities, it's clear to me that community-driven solutions are really the only thing that are going to get us there in terms of any kind of successful attempts around these issues. And that's where I get as well that not all communities are the same, and so we have to look at what works best in one place or another. The challenge is it can't be a blank check either, that there has to be accountability then and strengthening those relationships, both to find out ways to effectively work with those community groups and the communities to come up with solutions that they believe will work best there, but also then say if it doesn't, then we do have to change the path, and that's a tough one for some organizations in particular that you know, are pretty passionate, which is their greatest strength, but it's also a tough thing to say, you're right, it didn't work, so we need to find a different way. The last one I'll just mention briefly, because it's something that I've done a fair amount of work on, is around citizen engagement, because you talked about how do we get a better dialogue, and I think that's one that it's a rapidly changing field, but it is something that I worry about here. We go out and do consultations and engagement, we have community meetings, and it's maybe not as bad in Yellowknife, but when I go to the communities, the smaller communities, it's like, oh God, not another meeting. And so we got to find a way to be able to engage with citizens in a much more effective way, that it becomes a two-way street. Because the other thing that tends to happen as part of that bureaucracy is you go and you sit quietly, and nobody ever, as a bureaucrat, you're never supposed to say, well, no, you're just wrong on that. So it's one way, so you download and we write notes and then we go away. And I think that doesn't look particularly useful either. I think there's a lot of very passionate people that work for the government as well that want solutions. And so to find ways to take advantage, as you said, of both of those groups, I think is one that is a challenge, but we got to keep working on that, because I think that's really where the solutions lie. I think there's a lot of expertise that can be brought and married with a lot of passion and expertise at a community level to come up with solutions that actually can work.
I just wanted to highlight two little things to respond about. One is, in federal and territorial kind of arenas, where, say, massive amounts of fraud have happened and massive amounts of unaccountability, that's actually happened within the federal government and GNWT. That actually hasn't happened so much in the nonprofit sector. What happens, though, is when that happens in the government, they want us to be accountable. So if you look at the federal government, the, you know, massive amounts of money have disappeared. We have to account for pizzas that we buy, to account for something that we had nothing to do with. So again, just around accountability, it's important, but I think there's a double standard, and I think we have to address that. And the GNWT at one point had insisted and said, we're all going to learn how to do evaluations and we're going to be evaluated, but then they withdrew that resource. So we want to be evaluated. In fact, the non-government sector is like the top kind of sector that really reflects on itself and looks at how it's doing. I just wanted to put that out. The other sort of thing, just a big tip for the politicians, is that it's really kind of shocking when you constantly hear that there's no resources and we have to keep our economy in mind and we have to keep our limited resources in mind. When you can go from an $80 million bridge to $200 million bridge. So it's just, again, it's not picking on that particular thing, but again, it's a pattern. You know, last session I highlighted all of the, what do you call those? It's money that you didn't budget, but you get it.
Supplementaries.
So I highlighted all the supplementary requests, and every single department except one asked for supplementary money for important good things. So I looked at what they asked for, and I said, gee, well, that all makes sense to me. But the fact is they didn't budget for it. And the MLAs appear to me to rubber stamp it. Might not be true, but that's how I see it. So when it comes to the nonprofit sector, when we say there are real costs that are hitting us, I want a supplementary, what do you call it? I want one of those ability to at least say we need a supplementary appropriation because it makes sense. And so consider this, but we don't have the same avenue. And so I just want to talk about the double standard, both in terms of how those resources are kind of put out there and the accountability.
Last question.
Last but not least.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Kate, and I started out thinking I had so much that I wanted to say. But Aline said quite a few things. So I'll be just brief. You know, I sit in my office at Rock Hill, trying to help families reestablish their lives. I wish that those who do the policies will be sitting with me when a family comes. They will really know what the family needs. We've done so many researches. You know, we've been talking to families and doing needs assessment and doing all sorts of stuff, you know, around homelessness, around poverty, around issues that the families that we take care of, the people that we take care of, that these issues that they have. These issues have been teased apart, you know, so a woman who comes that has a child in trouble, that has no food on the table, that has no place to stay, has to go through so many different government organizations to get what they need. That is not right. And in the time being that we're sitting here you know, doing things and strategizing and trying to find ways, they are still coming and they are still hungry. It will be minus 40 pretty soon, and they'll be out sleeping in the cold at minus 40. And what is being done about that? I always say, we judge our communities by how they take care of their poor, and we're not doing a good job. And I've been in Yellowknife for quite a while, and it's not getting any better. I've seen second generation being homeless, and a third generation coming along. That is not right in Canada. It's got to change. I'm not providing any answers. I wish to be a part of any answers that people need. I would like to put in my input, but it's urgent and something needs to be done. We know these people are human beings, and human beings are important. And all the roads and everything that is being done for humans to enjoy. And it's got to be everybody. Everybody has to have the right to participate in this enjoyment. And some people are not supposed to be left behind. So let's put a sense of urgency around this. Like Arlene said, we've been spinning our wheels. I came here and I saw it. And it's been going on. And when will the action start? We need action. So please, let's put a sense of urgency on this and see how we can help the poor in our community. Because pretty soon, like I said, it's going to be our time. We're all going to be getting there sometime. You never know. You know, there is an African, proverb that says, you know, if somebody slips on a banana peel ahead of you, you don't laugh because you're going to get there. If the person slips and fall, you see it, you don't laugh. Because maybe when you get there and you slip and you fall, you might not get up. We're all going to get there someday because the slippery rope we're all, you know, doing, it affects us with our health. We'll think it's them, but it's coming to us. So please, let's all together do something and make this happen. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I think that brings us to an excellent grounding. And this is a report that's been prepared over several years. It's now been launched. That's the beginning. So we'll see what we can do with it. Thank you to Dr. David, Amanda, and Wendy for joining us today. And as was mentioned earlier, there's lunch available in front of the post office for those that have worked up an appetite on this exciting morning. Thank you all.
I want to thank our sponsors. Cernoc is the research project, multi-year research project, representation from throughout the country. That's the group that Arlene approached a couple of years ago for this research to start. We want to thank the Center for Northern Families. Arlene has been an outstanding research partner. Carleton University, got to thank them. I do want to graduate someday. The Homeless Hub, they're the folks that helped disseminate this. The Canadian Homelessness Research Network, they fund the Homeless Hub. That's your tax dollars at work. Also your tax dollars at work, Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council of Canada. They fund Cernoca and the Canadian Homelessness Research Network. INAC provided funding for my trip in March. They have something called the Northern Scientific Training Program that provides enough funding for one short trip to the north. And that's what I used in March to go to Ray and to come here also to talk to people about their reactions to a draft. Thank you very much. That is our contact information. And I think Arlene wants to say a few words now.
Well, the only other sort of two things I wanted to say is to thank the people in the government and in the service provider sector that participated in the research and spoke to Nick Falvo and really gave the foundation for that piece of research. The other thing I wanted to encourage you to do is really look on the Canadian Canadian Homeless Research Network website, which is called the Homeless Hub. And the really interesting thing about that is it has real short scenarios of what research is available there. The other piece of research that the YWCA spearheaded around women and homelessness in the North is on that website. And they have stories from people who are homeless. So it's a really well-balanced kind of website and a real resource for anyone working in the field of poverty and homelessness. So I'd encourage you to go to that website and, you know, participate in that and download documents that you think might be important or valuable to you.